In this video, we will explore the game set and its many interesting properties. To be able to understand these properties, we will take a detour to something which seems a little unrelated at first. By the end of the video, we will have a beautiful connection at our disposal, with which we can gain a deeper understanding of the game. Set is a quick-paced game of pattern matching, invented by Marcia Falco in 1974. The game is played using cards that vary in four features, each with three possibilities. We have the number of shapes, which can be either 1, 2, or 3. The color can be either green, red, or purple. The different shapes are the capsule, the diamond, and the squiggle. Finally, the shapes can be shaded in three different ways: open, striped, or solid. During the game, 12 cards are placed face up on the table. The players compete to find sets among these cards. A set is a collection of three cards, such that for each feature, it is either the same or all different over the three cards. Let us look more closely at an example of a set. All the colors are different, the number of shapes is different on each card, all the cards have the same shape on them, and finally, the shading is also different for each card. So, the three cards form a set. How about these three cards? They do not form a set because of the shapes. There are two squiggle cards and one diamond card. So, the shapes are not all the same, but also not all different. As an exercise, to test your understanding of the rules, you can pause the video and try to find 6 different sets in the displayed 12 cards. When a player finds a set, they take the cards and keep them for the score at the end of the game. The 3 taken cards are replaced with new ones from the deck. If no set can be found, 3 additional cards are added. If there is still no set, another 3 cards are added. In the extreme case that there are still no sets, a final 3 cards are added. At this point, there is guaranteed to be at least one set on the table. This is because 20 is the maximal number of cards you can place without having a set on the table. In general, we call a collection of cards with no sets a cap set. These 6 cards form a cap set, for example. You can verify for yourself that no matter which 3 cards you pick, they will not form a set. As I have already mentioned, the maximal size of such a set is 20. To understand these cap sets a little bit better, let us move to a simpler version of the game. By fixing the shading and color of the cards, there are now only 2 attributes which vary: the amount and shape. Consequently, we are left with just 9 cards. Can you find a maximal cap set in this simplified version? At the end of the video, we will look at how one can show the maximality of such a set. Let us now look at something seemingly unrelated: finite dimensional vector spaces. We illustrate these with the example of what mathematicians call F5 squared. The 5 indicates the number of points in each row and column, the 2 indicates that there are 2 dimensions. We have 2 fundamental operations: adding points and scaling points. To understand these better, we add coordinates to the points. To add 2 points, we just need to add their coordinates together to get a new point. What happens when the resulting point is outside the grid? To fix this problem, we wrap the points around, similarly to classic games like Snake or Asteroids. To scale points, we multiply the coordinates with a constant value and then wrap the points. Note that when we scale by 5, every point is sent to the origin. This is because, in this geometry, the value of 5 is the same as 0, so we were essentially just multiplying by 0. One way to visualize this is by placing the numbers on a circle. Due to the wrapping behavior, 5 lines up with 0. Formally, mathematicians denote this the following way. We say that 5 is equivalent to 0 modulo 5. What we have discussed so far is also possible for other prime numbers, like 3 or 7. Let us now look at the space F3 squared, which is of particular interest to us. In this space, multiples of 3 are equivalent to 0. Due to the geometric way these points are laid out, one might be interested in drawing lines through the points. But what exactly is a line in this case? The formula is exactly the same as for regular lines. The line passing through the points A and B is given by evaluating the formula at all values of t. This is where things are slightly different. Instead of using a real number for t, t can only be either 0, 1 or 2. Consequently, every line has exactly 3 points. Because of the wrapping, lines can look a little weird. To gain an alternative description, let us look at the coordinates of the points on the line separately. Plugging in t equal to 0 into the formula gives the first x-coordinate, x1. For t equal to 1, we get the second point's x-coordinate, x2. So, the value for t equal to 2 has to be the third point's x-coordinate, x3. Some manipulation of the formula gives that the coordinates sum to 0. We have shown that three distinct points lie on a line if and only if their coordinates sum to 0. Note that we didn't use the fact that there are only two coordinates. So, in general, three distinct points in F3 to the n lie on a line if and only if their coordinates sum to 0. This is a very useful fact that we will need many times. Notice that the coordinates sum to 0 precisely when they are all the same or all different. Doesn't that sound an awful lot like the rules for a set? Let us make this connection more explicit. For each feature, we have three possibilities. We can assign these the numbers 0, 1 and 2. For example, we can say that green is 0, red is 1 and purple is 2. This way, each card gets assigned a unique coordinate. Consider again the cards which have a solid shade and are green. We can view these as values of F3 squared by overlaying them on top of the 3x3 grid. Note that the coordinates of these cards correspond to the coordinates of the grid. Here is the important part. When I highlight any set, the corresponding points lie on a line. Conversely, any line is also a set. This is because three points are on a line exactly when the coordinates are either all the same or all different. Finding sets is exactly the same as finding lines. So far, we have only looked at the two-dimensional version of set. In the actual game, we have four different features, so the corresponding geometry has four dimensions. We can visualize this by laying the cards out in the following manner. There are two nested grids. The bigger grid is determined by the color and the number of shapes. The smaller grids are determined by the shading and the shape itself. To locate the card using the coordinates, we proceed as follows. Remember that we start counting from 0, so column 0 is the first column. The first two coordinates are for the bigger grid. The first coordinate tells us that we are in column 2. The second coordinate tells us that we are in row 1. Now, the last two coordinates tell us where we are in the smaller grid. Note that the choice of coordinates is sort of arbitrary. We could have chosen the following layout as well, for example. We'll see a bit more about this later. We are now ready to explore this beautiful connection between set and geometry. Let me summarize what we have seen so far. Each card has four distinct features, each with three possibilities. We can view the cards as points by assigning them coordinates based on their features. The goal of the game is to find sets. Mathematically, finding a set corresponds to finding three points on a line. We will now look at some simple but useful facts, with which we can finally tackle the question about cap sets. A line is completely determined by two points. Since each line has exactly three points, there is a unique third point for each pair of points. Similarly, for every pair of cards, there is a unique third card that forms a set. This property allows us to construct magic squares. Pick any three cards which do not form a set. For each pair, we have a unique third card that forms a set with the other two. This way, we get three new cards. Applying the same procedure to the new row gives another three cards. Applying the procedure a final time gives back the original three cards. What is going on here? Let me lay out the cards a bit differently this time. As you can see, they sort of form a magic square. All the lines in this grid correspond to sets. In essence, we're just drawing the original grid, but using different cards. Choosing the three cards at the start corresponds to changing coordinates. The three cards form what mathematicians call an affine basis for an affine plane. Each of these affine planes form magic squares. After all the lines form sets by construction. We will use this fact later on when we look more closely at cap sets. By choosing a card not in the square, we can create three more squares by completing sets. Finally, choosing a final card not in the three squares allows us to complete the whole grid. Note that all the highlighted grids form magic squares. Imagine a game of set such that at the end, three cards remain on the table. My claim is that those three cards will always form a set. To see this, partition the deck into sets. We have already seen that the points in a set add up to 0. So, by adding all the cards in the deck, we still get a total of 0. When a set is removed, the sum of the remaining cards will still be 0. Hence, by the end of the game, the cards that are left on the table add to 0. So, if there are 3 cards remaining, the sum must be 0, and hence they must form a set. What if there are 6 cards remaining? It is possible that these don't form a set, but we can still do a nice trick here. By pairing them up, we can complete the pairs like we did before. Since we end up with 3 sets this way, the sum of all the cards must be 0. But since the 6 cards are the remaining cards after a game, their sum is also 0. Hence, the sum of the 3 constructed cards is 0, and they must form a set. Let us now go back to the question of cap sets. Recall that a cap set is a collection of cards that do not contain any sets. The question was what the maximal size of such a set could be. We restricted ourselves to a simplified version of the game with just these 9 cards. In this case, we will refer to these sets as 2 caps to indicate that we are working in 2 dimensions. It is quite easy to find a 2 cap of size 4. We just need to show that any collection of 5 cards contains at least one set. Assume that there is a 2 cap with 5 points x1, x2, x3, x4 and x5. Divide the grid into 3 horizontal lines. Since the points form a 2 cap, there can be at most 2 points on each line. Otherwise, the 3 points would form a set. There will be 1 line with 1 point and 2 lines with 2 points. We may assume that x5 is on the line with just 1 point. There are exactly 4 lines which go through any given point. Of the 4 lines through x5, the horizontal one contains none of the other points. We have 3 lines and 4 points remaining. By the pigeonhole principle, there must be at least 1 line which contains 2 of the missing points. But then those points form a set together with x5, a contradiction. Hence, there can be no 2 cap of size 5. For 3 caps, the maximal size is 9. Here is an example. Let us now show that there is no 3 cap of size 10. The proof is a little bit more involved, but still doable. Suppose that there is a 3 cap with 10 points. For each of the 3 planes, the points in that plane must form a 2 cap. So, there can be at most 4 points in each plane. Without loss of generality, the middle plane contains either 2 or 3 points. There are at least 7 points not on the middle plane. Picking 2 points on the middle plane, there are exactly 4 planes which go through those 2 points. Again, using the pigeonhole principle, there must be at least one plane containing 3 of the remaining points. After all, we have to distribute 7 remaining points over 3 planes. But then, that plane contains 5 points, and we have already shown that this means that it contains a set. This is a contradiction, and we conclude that there is no 3 cap of size 10. The maximal size of a 4 cap is 20. Here is an example. Sadly, the techniques used in the previous proofs don't work for the 4D case. In general, it is a very difficult problem to find the maximal size of a D cap. At the time of recording, these are the only known values. Perhaps surprisingly, these cap sets appear in other areas of mathematics and research is still being done on them today. There is much more to say about the game set, but I will end the video here. For those who are eager to learn more, there are plenty of resources available online. I have linked the sources that I used for this video in the description.